chariot stopping, let me ride.
Swing
round, swing chariot stopping, let me ride. Rock me Lord, I'm going easy. I've got a home on the other side.
Well, I looked over Jordan, what did I see?
Coming for to carry me home.
A band of angels coming after me.
Coming for to carry me home.
Swing down,
chariot stopping.
And welcome. I'm deliberately standing a little bit off center because I realize that if I stand bang in the center, it looks like I've got tulips growing up my hair. So, there you go. It suits me. Yeah. Well, it maybe suits me, but I'm not going to take up that particular line. So welcome. Lovely to have you with us here on a pretty dreek Aberdeen day. But this is springtime and Scotland, so at least it's not 6 foot under snow or anything like that. And those of you joining us online as well, a very warm welcome to you also. We're glad to have you with us in this way. And I hope that you're enjoying your lunch here. This is, as you're aware, it's Holy Week. It starts always with Palm Sunday, when we remember how Jesus rode into Jerusalem and he was welcomed there as king. And it moves on through that week. The Friday he was crucified, and on the Sunday risen from the dead again. So for those who are believers, it's always a pretty special week. And we want just to make it a kind of special week as well for yourselves, and really just give you the opportunity in the middle of the day on a Wednesday to think through a little bit of what was going on. And I thought I might start with an experience that I had as a grandfather a number of years ago, where I took my two older granddaughters to the cinema. And I thought that was a fairly safe experience, a safe sort of outing that we were going to have, because just going to the cinema with a child-rated movie that was called The Secret Life of Pets. I don't know if anybody's seen The Secret Life of Pets. Yeah, I thought it's pretty safe. Yeah, just, you know, it's kind of animated stuff and it's pets and it's all of that sort of stuff. By about 20 minutes in, the older granddaughter was terrified out of her wits, and she was just clinging onto me for dear life. No one had advised me as to how to handle that sort of thing. And she said, "What's going to happen? What's going to happen?" And I hadn't seen the film, so I had no clue what was going to happen. But I had to say to her, "It's all going to end fine. Don't worry. Don't worry. It's going to be all right in the end." And she said, "Are you sure?" And well, I was, you know, I said, "Yeah, I'm sure." Because I figured that they would not show a film like that for children if it didn't have a kind of reasonably decent ending like that. So I guaranteed, said, "Yeah, you just cling on, it'll be fine in the end, stick there." And this week, obviously, Holy Week, is a week in which we are thinking about how things end, how things ended for Jesus. And it made me think about some of the films that I've seen and how they end. And some of them are pretty dramatic, and some of them are kind of you're holding onto your seat wondering just how they're going to end like that. One of the ones that is really very, very spectacular is a film called Behind Enemy Lines. Seen that? Behind Enemy Lines. And that's how it ends. The guy's kind of in the kind of Balkan Wars, and he's kind of crash landed, and he has to get out, and it's touch and go without spoiling the film for you. Well, I have spoiled the film for you because it's got a happy ending, but that's how it ends. The kind of the helicopters appear over the horizon there just in the nick of time, and there's the rope fling down, and he just runs off the edge of the cliff and grabs on, and the guy is safe like that. I don't know how they film that sort of thing, because it just looks pretty spectacular. It reminded me as well of a film that I saw when I was just a boy. It was one of the earlier films that I saw. It was 1965, I think it came out, and it was called Von Ryan's Express. Seen that? That was Frank Sinatra when he wasn't singing. He was an actor, and Von Ryan's Express starred Frank Sinatra, and that really is how it ends as well. And it ends with him kind of running along the railway line, trying to get away from the soldiers who are out to get him like that, and trying to get onto the train. And you can see there reaching out, and it was devastating for me because have you seen it? Okay, some of you have seen it. Those of you who haven't seen it, do you plan ever to see it? I mean, you do. Well, shut your ears then for the minute, because all I'll say is that it was a shock to the system. It was the first time in my life that anything I'd seen or read did not have a happy ending. And you got your ears shut, so you don't listen to this, but this is okay. The guy ends up dead. He doesn't make it. And it was devastating for me because I'd kind of been brought up, all the stories that I'd read, you know, they all lived happily ever after and things like that. And I kind of assumed that that's just how it always was. And here was a film that showed something and it did not have a happy ending. And it's that sort of thing that is going on as the record of the life and ministry of Jesus moves towards its climax. And through the course of the narrative, we've seen who Jesus is, what he does, the things that he does, the things that he teaches, the way that he clearly divides the crowds of people. And some people love him, some people clearly don't like him at all. And he ends up hung on this cross. We're going to read just a few verses from there as we enter into the story. I'll put them on the screen for you. So this is from Mark chapter 15. Mark's one of the ones who tells us what happened to Jesus. At noon, and this is on the Friday of that week, at noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. A very strange experience. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, as well that he put this because most of us don't speak Aramaic like that, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Let me just pause this there. I guess we experience things like that, I suppose, in our own lives sometimes. Times when it does just get strangely dark. not necessarily with the weather, not necessarily with the kind of physical darkness, but our experience becomes suddenly dark, and it seems like the light just goes out in our lives. Sometimes it's illness, sometimes it's bereavement, sometimes just problems seem to mount up, all sorts of different things, and it just seems all really dark. And it was a strange darkness on that occasion. And here was this Jesus who had lived such a remarkable life, taught such wonderful truth, changed so many lives in very wonderful ways. And there he was being cruelly, unjustly nailed to a cross and suffering what is to this day probably still the most agonizing and wretched way of killing someone. Crucifixion. The Romans invented it, and it's a really very, very cruel way of killing someone. Very painful, very prolonged, and there he is hung on the cross. It's a dark day. It's an unjust death that he's dying, and his experience is one in which he feels utterly forsaken, not just by his friends, but by God himself. And there are times in our experience where that's our experience. It just seems nothing is going right for us. We're sore. We feel that life is not treating us fairly. We've done our best, done our bit, and it just all seems to be going wrong. And we can feel pretty isolated, pretty much on our own. And one of the comforts, I suppose, for us is that this Jesus, at least, he knows what that's like. And the narrative goes on in the next couple of verses. When some of those standing near heard this, remember he was crying out, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani." When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." And someone ran. Elijah was a kind of prophet from way, way back. Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "And now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. Now, what's going on there is these are folk who have been brought up on the sort of things in their day that I was brought up on. I was, I would watch the Western movies, John Wayne and that sort of thing. And those Western movies, always just in the nick of time, over the horizon, the cavalry would arrive. And they would kind of sort things out, and all would end up happily eventually in that sort of way. And that's what they're assuming, that somehow at this critical moment in the nick of time, maybe someone like Elijah is just going to pitch up. Elijah was a prophet from those hundreds of years earlier who was used by God to do some very miraculous things. And they kind of assume maybe the kind of cavalry from heaven are going to pitch up and he's going to be okay in the end of the day. And that's not how it ends. Verse 37, "With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, 'Surely this man was the Son of God.'" And so if you were a spectator at that moment, watching the darkness coming down, Jesus crying out in agony on the cross in the darkness, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And then he breathes his last. You'd wondered, would there be a kind of last minute reprieve? Would somehow or other he be saved? And no, he breathes his last. Finito, period, end of story. And if that's the end, you're thinking, well, yeah, that's a very sad end. Not the way you'd want it to end, not the way you'd wish it to end, not the way you'd thought it would end, but just the end. And yet, the narrative makes it clear that actually that's not the end. Two things happened, two remarkable things, one of which helped people see who Jesus is, and one of which help people understand what he'd come to do. And the very first thing that Mark mentions is that something quite astonishing happened in the temple. The temple was the kind of building where there was a sense of the presence of God, who comes to be with us in our trouble, in our need, in our difficulties, and so on. And the temple had this big curtain. God is holy, God is good. You can't get really near to God because we're anything but that. And something quite remarkable happened in the temple. The curtain there in the temple, it tore from top to bottom. It was kind of split aside. It was like because of Jesus' death, because he's, as it were, stood in our place and borne the consequences of all our wrongdoing, there is now a way opened up for us to be able to enjoy the presence of Almighty God. And that was remarkable, an indication, a visual indication of what it is that Jesus has come to do, to provide a way whereby no matter who we are, no matter how dark our experience is, no matter how dark our past may be or our present may be, we may nonetheless draw near to God. We may know him with an immediacy in that way. And astonishingly, this tough Roman centurion, a veteran of war, and they didn't fight pretty back in those days at all. No Geneva Convention. It was pretty rural, pretty mucky, and pretty nasty, the warfare. This veteran of Roman war, as he stands there, he is persuaded. He has never seen anyone like this before and cries out, surely this, now I've seen what God is like. This is what God is like. This is divine. There is something quite astonishing about the manner in which this person has died. And an awareness that, yeah, this is God who has come into our world, stood in for us, taken our place, and borne himself the consequence of all our wrongdoing. And so there is a real sense in which, as all of this is recorded for us, the writers are wanting us to understand this isn't the end of the story. In some ways, it's just the beginning of the real story, because this Jesus, who is the very Son of God, took our place, dies that death, opened up a way that you and I may know God in our day-by-day lives, which is thrilling and astonishing. He has now come back to life as well, risen from the dead. We celebrate that on Sunday, Easter Sunday. And the key thing is, as many of these writers point to, is that you and I need to learn to look to him, to reach out for him. And so you have this picture superimposed on the narrative there of the cross, the picture of the guy reaching out, because there has come down from on high, there has come down from above the very Son of God and given to us in the death that he died a lifeline. And we are by faith to reach out and lay hold of him and make him our own and recognize that as we do so, our story too doesn't have an end like that. It just begins to open up to a whole new future. Quite a remarkable thing that has happened that we celebrate in Easter week always in the death of Jesus on what we call Good Friday. God himself come down to give to us the lifeline that we need, that provides for us a way out of our past and into his future. And may that be your experience, this Jesus who came into this world, lived that life, died that death, now risen, alive, reaching out to us as well and saying, I'm here for you. Lay hold of me. Let me pray as we close. Lord, thank you for all that you are, for all that you've done. And as this week we mark again what it is that you came and did by bearing that death in our place, bearing yourself that utter, bleak, dreadful, God-forsakenness on account of our wrongdoing, we thank you that you declare to us that in him, no matter who we are, there is forgiveness. There is a new start, and you open up to us a whole new future. And so we'd ask simply that you would help us to reach out again and just lay hold of your risen Son and know what it is in him to live. Thank you for all your good gifts to us. Grant your continued blessing on us for Jesus' sake. Amen. Good. Well, enjoy the rest of your lunch. We do have a service on Friday evening, 7:30, if you want to join us for that, when we mark again the death of Jesus, and our Easter Sunday services, an all-age one on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, and then our regular evening service on Easter Sunday at 6:30. Enjoy the rest of your lunch and the rest of the week.